the Colgate Red Raiders will take on the host Cornell Big Red. This is the 94th meeting between the two schools. Rivalry dates back to 1896. And here come the Colgate Red Raiders onto the field. Under the direction of 12-year head coach Fred Dunlap, the Red Raiders come in with a record of 2-1. Victories over Bucknell and William and Mary, a defeat at the hands of Division 1A Duke.
Testing 1, 2, 3, 4.
Last season, the Cornell Big Red snapped a six-game Red Raider winning streak in this rivalry. Cornell won last year's matchup in Hamilton, New York by a score of 21-12. The Red Raiders of Colgate had won the previous six meetings between the two schools. As a matter of fact, Colgate has not lost here in Ithaca since 1979, when the Big Red defeated them by a score of 36-21. There's Fred Dunlap, the head coach of the Colgate Red Raiders. We're awaiting the arrival of the Cornell Big Red, and here they come out of their locker room. The Big Red 1-0, their season opening victory 1 week ago at Franklin Field in Philadelphia against the defending Ivy League champions, the Penn Quakers. The Cornell program has turned completely around. The Big Red 8-2 a year ago under fifth-year head coach Maxie Baum.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Ivy League football game of the week from Schoolcraft Field in Ithaca, New York. It's nice to have you with us coast to coast on PBS, and it's a pleasure for me to be joined by my usual partners. On my right, our sideline reporter, Mike Madden. On my left, our color commentator, Jack Corrigan. Jack, I think our viewers across the country are going to have a real treat today in seeing a running back that perhaps they've not heard a lot about for Colgate, but he's one of the best in the country, Kenny Gamble.
Kenny Gamble is not only one of the best 1AA runners in the country, he may be one of the best runners overall in the nation this year. He's got good speed, great cutback ability, and the strength to be able to knock tacklers off of him. Cornell is definitely going to have to get a lot of good work out of their two defensive ends. Stuart Tross, who was the Ivy League Player of the Week last week, and Mike Texedo did an excellent job of cutting off Chris Flynn. They've got to do that against Kenny Gamble, and it's a little bit more difficult of an assignment.
It seems if the Cornell defense is going to get any help in that regard, they might be helped by the Colgate offense. Kenny Gamble, despite his many great abilities, is prone to fumbling, and the Colgate offense has had some trouble putting the ball in the end zone.
They've really had some difficulty in finishing off what they have started. Last week against William and Mary, the Red Raiders had 310 yards of total offense in just the second half, but scored no points in the final two periods. Last year against Cornell, it was turnovers that plagued the Red Raiders. Cornell's hoping for more of the same today.
Cornell offensively last week in their upset win against Penn got a great performance from rookie quarterback Aaron Samita. Mike, what will Colgate and Cornell do as far as when Cornell has the ball today?
Well, Samita's got a tough task ahead of him, Sean. Colgate, they stopped the run very effectively. They've given up 1.3 yards average rush all year long, and they do it with their front four people. They line up four guys in the down stance. Their linebackers, their secondary people are way off the ball, and they stop the run with those four. What they're going to have to do is they're going to have to bring the linebackers up, Cornell is, and they're going to have to bring the secondary people up. And the way they do that is when you run, you got to run effectively. The other way you can do it is short passes, hitches out to your wide guys, dumps to your tight end. That should bring these people up. Later on in the game, Aaron Samita could look downfield to Chris Hahn, Sean Hawkins, and Sam Brickley, which is, they are the strength of this Cornell offense.
All right, Mike, we look forward to hearing your comments from the sideline this afternoon on the Ivy League football game of the week. And we'll be back at Schoolcraft Field in just a moment.
The Ivy League football game of the week is made possible by a grant from the financial professionals at Payne Weber. And by a grant from Chrysler Plymouth. We're working together to be the best. We are set for the opening kickoff in today's Ivy League football game of the week between Colgate and Cornell. Colgate will kick off. Colgate won the toss and deferred its choice to the second half. Cornell then opted to receive. Colgate, dressed in white, will kick off. They'll move from right to left as you watch it in the first quarter. Cornell, dressed in their home red, will move from left to right. And it's Rory Crump, the freshman from Friendswood, Texas, to kick it off for Colgate.
Kicking off for Colgate, number 16, Rory.
The clouds have moved in here in Ithaca, New York. It was a beautiful morning. The sun was shining brightly. The temperature is in the low 60s at game time. Wind blowing across the field from left to right as Crump kicks it off. Sam Brickley, number 17. Back deep to receive for Cornell. He's back there with number 37, Frank Manego. Brickley returned all three kickoffs last week against Penn for an average of 27.7 yards per return. He starts along the hash mark and moves his way up to the 30-yard line. Sam Brickley brings it back to the 30, and that's where Cornell sets up first and 10. They're led offensively by number 10, Aaron Samita. In the backfield, along with Samita, the running backs are Marvin Dunklin and Scott Melliga. The wide receivers, Chris Hahn and Sean Hawkins, and Mark Warrington is the tight end. The offensive line for Cornell. Two juniors, Kate Beck and Langan Hazeltine, also a junior, Davis and Reardon are seniors. High formation behind Samita on first and 10. They fake the pitch to Dunklin. Pass to the near side, intercepted! Intercepted along the near sideline and tackled with the football for Colgate Sheldon Spicer, number 3. He had a lot of real estate between he and the goal line for a moment, but a saving tackle was made and a big break right off the opening series for Colgate.
Nick Pano slanting in from his left defensive end forced Samita to throw this ball badly. Sheldon Spicer, the only guy out there, and it was a great tackle by Chris Hahn that kept it from being an early Colgate score.
So Colgate comes on offense after the fourth interception of the season for Sheldon Spicer, the senior from Rochester, New York. The quarterback for Colgate, number 10, Gary Aurora. He pitches to number 2, Kenny Gamble. And he is stopped at the 20-yard line by Mike Rage, number 13, the All-Ivy quarterback for Cornell.
That's what Cornell has got to be able to do against Kenny Gamble. Stretch the defense, force him to eventually turn upfield where you've got help. There you see the Colgate backfield and secondary. Number 2, Kenny Gamble, the guy you got to watch, and a sophomore quarterback, Gary Aurora. Among the men up front, Brian Smith, the lone returning starter from a year ago. He's at right guard.
And those offensive linemen, all seniors, with the exception of Mike Cote, Jr. Kenny Gamble nowhere once again. He didn't even make it back to the 20-yard line. Colgate facing a third down and 7 situation from the Cornell 20. We've played 1 minute, no score here in Ithaca.
One of the things that Cornell does very effectively is get great support from the secondary, because I tell you, Rach and Delamalore and Felito and Mark Perlman, all excellent open field tackles.
Gary Aurora, sophomore from Hamden, Connecticut, at quarterback for Colgate. Quick count, he drops straight back. Here comes pressure, throws toward the end zone, and it's dropped by Buddy Brown. Mark Perlman was on coverage for Cornell, but Brown had a catchable ball and couldn't haul it in.
Mike McGran was coming on a stunt to the inside from his outside linebacker position in a little bit of a loop. He was providing late pressure on Aurora. Buddy Brown had a chance for the score, but he took his eye off it, banged off the shoulder pads, and the try for the 6 goes awry. The left try for the field goal now.
Rory Crump back on the field. 3 for 5 as a field goal kicker. He's had his trouble with extra points this year. He's 3 for 7 on PATs. This will be a 38-yard attempt out of the hold of A.J. Thomas. Kick is long enough, and it is no good. Wide to the left.
And we've got a flag on the play, a little bit of an altercation between a Colgate and Cornell player. The question is, will it take place after the kick? To see in the possession, Len Tokish was one of the guys involved for Cornell.
Our referee today is Newton Whitaker. He's talking it over with his fellow officials.
Dead ball foul, personal foul.
It was a dead ball foul, so Cornell will get possession but be backed up inside their 20, back on about the 10-yard line.
Apparently Newton Whitaker's microphone is not working. We will work to correct that problem. Cornell, right out the opening gun here, dodges a big bullet.
And once again, early on, as we look at the Colgate defense, now the guy you got to watch is 74, Tony Khalif. He's a defensive left tackle, and 58, Greg Minuski, the middle linebacker, Spicer, who made the interception. Colgate, again, the problems they've had all year. They get down deep in their opposition's territory and can't put it in the end zone.
Cornell back on offense, first and 10 from its own 10. The handoff goes to Marvin Dunklin. He'll go nowhere. Spicer up to make the play with help from Kyle Warwick, number 41.
It's actually a first and 20 because of that dead ball call against the Big Red. They have to get out to the 31-yard line. They spot the ball in about the 11, so it's a second and 20 situation. One of the things Cornell is concerned about this afternoon is trying to run against that very physical defensive front 4 of the Red Raiders.
Malaga and McDevitt now the backs behind Samita. Tim McDevitt, number 34, takes the handoff, and he gets very little. McDevitt, a junior from Levittown, New York. Third down long. Facing Cornell, Maxie Bond told us last week that in some of these situations, he would quick kick this season. He's backed up at his own 11-yard line, facing a third down and 19. This might be just the situation for it.
Couple of substitutions both ways. Colgate goes to their nickel defense, adding an extra defensive back and just three down linemen.
All kinds of movement for Cornell. And a whistle stops the play. I believe it's delay of game against the Big Red as the 25-second clock had ticked down. It is delay of game, and that will back the Big Red up inside the 10-6. And they will face a third down and 24 situation. No score, 12-13 to play in the first quarter. It's Cornell and Colgate in the Ivy League football game of the week.
No, not deep in your own territory either.
Samita hands it off to Malaga, and he gets nowhere. Tripped up at the line of scrimmage by Mark D'Angelo, number 70. Backup defensive tackle and a junior from Jamestown, New York. So pressure on the punter early. And we talked last week about Tom Coben, the sophomore punter from Mendham, New Jersey. Kicking in his first collegiate game a week ago, punted four times against Penn. It's a low snap. Coben, the left footer, gets it away. A short kick. Brian Carroll, the deep man, lets it bounce a couple of times. And it's down at the 40-yard line. Coben averaged 32.8 yards per punt a week ago, and that kick, a 35-yarder.
Once again, the Red Raiders will have excellent field position. The key to their offense, not so much Kenny Gamble. You know Gamble is going to be able to do his things. It's Gary Aurora, the young option-type quarterback for Freddie Dunlap. How well he performs this afternoon goes a long way in determining how successful Colgate will be.
Aurora rolls to his left, looking to throw. I will tuck it under and run. As Jack pointed out, he can run. He's inside the 30, down at the 27-yard line, where Mike Raich and Rick Calhoun, numbers 13 and 97, respectively, made the tackle.
Run out of bounds.
This time,
13,
as Colgate Raich rolled out, the Cornell defense was stretched properly. It was just good blocking by the people on the corner as they chopped down Stuart Tross, the defensive end on that side, and also the linebacker, Mike Farley, and that got Aurora around the corner.
Gary Aurora was the ECAC 1AA Rookie of the Week for his performance last week against William & Mary when he was 20 of 36. He's going to the end zone for Buddy Brown, and there was a collision in the end zone between Brown and Perlman. Brent Folato arguing for a flag against Brown, the receiver, who seemed to knock down Perlman, but there's no flag in the end zone.
I would say there's little question about contact from Buddy Brown here, because Perlman has got a chance to catch this ball if Brown doesn't tangle him up. Inadvertent or otherwise, contact affected the play. There probably should have been a call there.
Instead, it's second and 10 for Colgate from the Cornell 27. An interception by Sheldon Spicer on the opening series put Colgate in great shape from a field position standpoint, but they've yet to capitalize on it as Aurora is dropped by Mike McGran, number 56, the left outside linebacker and the junior from Houston, Texas.
The key in stopping an option attack offensively is to decide immediately with your linebacker. Either he's going to take the quarterback right now or he's going to take out the pitch man right now. That time McGran said the quarterback is mine and shut the play down.
Third and a long 9 from the 26. No score. 10:25 to play in the first quarter. A flag down as Gamble takes the pitch. He's knocked out of bounds at the 20. Short of a first down by about 2.5 yards, but let's check out the penalty.
I think this will be a freebie for Colgate. It looked like Cornell had jumped on the right side of the defensive line. They do get the free play. Instead of fourth and a couple, it'll be another third down play for the Red Raiders. Third and about 4.
Because we jump, it's still offside penalty.
You got
offside, McGran. Third and 5.
Your Newton Whitaker, our official. You got a little bit of a taste there of Kenny Gamble's ability, Sean, against a defense really geared to stop him. They went the sweep action with him to the short side of the field, and even though there wasn't a lot of room to run, he still managed to get about 8 yards on that play.
Gamble, the tailback, Todd Buckner, number 12, the fullback behind Aurora. He rolls right, throws. It's complete to A.J. Thomas along the sideline. He's inside the five and knocked out of bounds at the 2-yard line. First and goal, Colgate from the two.
Once again, Aurora able to break the contain on the left side of the Cornell defense, and he threw a strike here to A.J. Thomas. Brent Felito goes for the interception. He's not going to get there, and Thomas is in the end zone. DeLamalore and Perlman stop him 2 yards shy, but Colgate knocking on the door again here in the first period.
10th catch of the season for A.J. Thomas. First and goal from the two, Aurora. Into the end zone, touchdown. Mike Gorey made the reception, but there are flags down on the play.
Number 86, Gorey for a touchdown.
And it will go against the Red Raiders once again. Colgate having problems down inside the 20-yard line, this time down inside the five. They lose a touchdown, at least for the moment anyway, because of mistakes.
Illegal offense. Still first.
Penalty against Colgate.
They went with a quick count that time, Sean, and unfortunately they didn't set long enough, and it was a good play. And this changes a lot of what you're going to do. Not only did you lose the yardage, but you change your philosophy now in terms of your play calling.
First and goal from the 7. 10-10 to play, first quarter, no score. Gamble up the middle. Stopped at the 4-yard line. He lunged ahead for an extra half yard. Stuart Tross, number 90, made the tackle as Fred Dunlap considers the play call here on second and goal from just inside the 4.
That's Damon Phelan, number 7, the backup quarterback who started last year against the Big Red and played pretty well in the sophomore season. But Gary Aurora just came on this year for the Red Raiders, and he's at the controls for Colgate.
Again, Gamble into the middle of the line. Bounced off one tackle, but still stopped well short of the goal line. Mitch Lee, number 23, made the initial hit.
Watch the offensive and defensive lines go at it here. I mean, you want to talk about heavy-duty contact. You get it down near the goal line. Felito and Lee were there with first contact, but Kenny Gamble, he made a yard out of that when he had no business getting a yard out of it. But a big third and goal situation here for Colgate. I think they're going to come to the wide side of the field here. That'll be to Colgate's left.
Three men in the backfield. Now Buddy Brown comes in motion. Aurora looking toward the end zone. Now he's going to run, and he'll be stopped short of the goal line. Mike Farley made the initial hit that threw Aurora off balance, and then there was help from several other Cornell Big Red defenders. Fourth and goal from just inside the 1, and decision time for Fred Dunlap.
They really put pressure on the defense here. If you go on Aurora, he can dump it to Gamble, but he waited too long to make the decision, and the good contact by Farley keeps it a yard away. Freddie Dunlap says they're not going to try the field goal. We're going for 6 here. Big play early in the ball game.
Again, 3 backs behind Gary Aurora. Gamble over the top, he didn't make it. Stuffed by the Cornell defense, and the Big Red takes over on downs. First and 10 from their own 1.
What a stand, and how important was that penalty? The Raiders have a touchdown taken off the board. Watch the contact at the top of the pile. Mitchell Lee. I mean to tell you, that young man, the sophomore from Rochester, New York, he's going to be a name very big in Cornell football before he's done.
The Big Red certainly not out of the woods yet. They're backed up at their own goal line. Samita, quarterback sneak, tries to push it ahead and get some breathing room for Cornell.
The thing to consider here, though, Sean, regardless of what Cornell does in this particular possession, is that Colgate, as this continues to happen to them, possession after possession, now into their 4th game of the season, they have to start to wonder every time they get down into scoring territory. Can we put it in, or what are we going to do this time to break down? That may come to be a big factor in this game.
They were concerned about that after last week's game against William & Mary. Scott Malaga breaks free. He picks up a first down for Cornell out to the 18-yard line. Don Charney, number five, had to make the tackle in the secondary for Colgate.
And last week, after being very right-hand oriented, Cornell running the football has gone more to the left this afternoon. Excellent block by Todd Nicholson in front of Malaga to spring him into the secondary. The Big Red gets its first down.
Those numbers made Scott Malaga the leading rusher in the ball game last week against Penn. First and 10 for Cornell. Sam Brickley, number 17, comes in motion. Again, Malaga gets the call, and he's stuffed by the middle of the Colgate defense, led by linebacker Greg Minuski, leading tackler for the Colgate Red Raiders, the senior, number 58, from Wyoming, Pennsylvania.
Minuski at middle linebacker, and Tony Khalif, number 74, in front of Minuski, make it very difficult to run straight ahead. You've got to do some kind of deception to work against those two guys. Khalif, at 260 pounds of tackle, is a load.
Both Khalif and Minuski, first-team All-Colonial League players last season. On second and nine, Marvin Dunklin runs right, breaks the tackle. He's across the 25 and out to the 30-yard line. First down, Cornell. Marvin Dunklin, the senior from Cannonsburg, Pennsylvania, just 5'8", 151 pounds, but he broke through a tackle at the line of scrimmage.
Cornell ran the student body right that time, also had a wing back over there as well to provide some help. Mr. Dunklin, as you said, not very big, but with some help, was able to turn the corner.
No score, 6:15 to play, first quarter here at Schulcoff Field in Ithaca. Cornell hosting Colgate. Scott Malaga, good yardage on first down. He picked up five. He was tackled by Mark D'Angelo, number 70.
We talked about confidence and the question of confidence right now for Colgate after failing to score twice deep in Cornell territory. Last year, Cornell could not run the ball at all against Colgate. Here, within the shadow of their own goalposts, they've pushed it out 35 yards now, strictly on the ground. That's got to be a boost for this offense.
Colgate is fifth in the nation in rushing defense this season. They've given up just 49 yards per game to their opponents on the ground, but Colgate has given up yardage to Cornell on the ground, and Cornell really a passing team, not a running team.
Interesting third down call here for Eddie Wilson, the offensive coordinator, and Maxie Bohn and the rest of his staff. Third down and a long four. But the fact that they picked up a couple of first downs to give themselves some room that if they have to punt the ball with Tom Coben, they're a lot better off than they were the first time they had the football.
Let's get it, Doug.
Third and four from the 37.
Let's get it.
The pitch goes to Dunklin. Dunklin will be stopped short of the first down by Greg Minuski. He made the tackle at the 39-yard line. It will be fourth and two and the second punt of the afternoon upcoming for Tom Coben.
Watch Greg Minuski, the middle linebacker. This guy had 162 tackles last year doing things just like that.
Brian Carroll back deep to receive the punt from Tom Coben. Good boot by Coben, fielded by Carroll at his 25, and he was tripped up right away by Evan Park, number 20. Carroll managed to stumble forward for about 4 yards, and Colgate takes over first and 10, just inside its own 30. That's the worst field position of the quarter by far for the Red Raiders.
First time we will see probably the basic offensive package now of Colgate. The other two times they were deep in the scoring zone. You do a little bit different style of offense down close.
High formation behind Gary Arora. Takes the handoff to Gamble. Over the middle, wide open, Buddy Brown at the 50. He's inside Cornell territory, dragged down by Jeff DeLaMalure, the weak safety, at the Cornell 48. Big gain of 22 yards on first down for Colgate. First and 10, Red Raiders.
Buddy Brown, he's caught 80 passes in his Colgate career. He's been a 3-year starter, finds the hole in the zone. The good play action forces the defense to get into a basic zone coverage, and Brown was able to find the open spot.
Brown, first team All-Colonial League selection last year. He's from Hollywood, Florida, a senior. Run. The pitch to Gamble. Up the middle and stopped at the 45-yard line. Mike McGrand led the defensive surge for the Big Red.
Gamble,
Elsewhere around the Ivy League this afternoon, Columbia is at Lafayette. The Lions trying to end their 32-game losing streak. Rhode Island is at Brown in that traditional rivalry. Dartmouth at New Hampshire, Northeastern at Harvard. Northeastern off to a 2-0 start. Penn at Bucknell, Princeton at Davidson, and Connecticut is at Yale. Gain of two on first down for Gamble. Second and eight from the Cornell 46. Gamble, senior from Holyoke, Massachusetts. Across the 40, inside the 35, and dragged down by Mike Raich at the 30-yard line. Gain of 16 for Kenny Gamble, first and 10, Colgate at the 30.
Kenny Gamble, who of course has got an awful lot of talent, gets some excellent help. I tell you what, Colgate does a great job of blocking on the corners. Look at Felito taken care of, and downfield, Rick Evans was working on Raich, and although Mike made the tackle, he still enabled Gamble to get a little further upfield. Look at those numbers.
We're going to talk a lot this afternoon about the many records that Kenny Gamble has set. That pass was deflected near the line of scrimmage and incomplete, intended for Mike Ori. Jeff DeLamalure, number 46, who had a great game last week against Penn, he was on the coverage.
I tell you what, this Cornell secondary tackles as well as anybody in football, period. They might not have some of the size and speed that you might find in some other programs, but boy, they don't like to stick you.
Five defensive backs now into the game for Cornell. Corky Webb, number 22, is the nickelback. Gamble gets the pitch, and Corky Webb makes the stop. The nickelback, the senior from Rochester, New York, number 22.
Pete Noyes, the defensive coordinator for the Big Red, says that Corky Webb would be starting on a lot of other ball clubs, but Cornell, with the experience in the secondary, it moves Webb into that nickelback role. But that's a big stick there, because now Colgate with a third and long situation. Got to expect probably some type of pass here, and therefore you're going to look for number one, Buddy Brown. He'll go out to the right side along with A.J. Thomas in a twin set.
It's actually third and about eight. Said third and six on your screen. Aurora trying to move away from Len Tokish, giving up more ground, and he'll be in the grasp of the 50 and dragged down at the 46.
Stuart Tross, Mike Tuxedo, the defensive ends, finish off what Len Tokish began. And Gary Aurora made a very sophomore-like mistake there. When he got in trouble, he backpedaled. He was looking for a block from Newton Whitaker, the referee.
He got it.
But there's Tross and Tuxedo, 90 and 95. They were big last week. They've been big performers already here this afternoon.
Tross had three sacks last week against Penn and was the Ivy League Player of the Week. Rory Crump, the freshman, on the punt. Aiming for the corner, Mike Raich will let it go, and it will bound into the end zone. So Cornell on the touchback will take it over. First and 10 at their own 20 with 1:15 to play in a scoreless first quarter here at Schoolcraft Field in Ithaca. Sean McDonough along with Jack Corrigan and Mike Madden bringing you the Ivy League football game of the week, coast to coast on PBS.
Best field position Cornell's had in a while.
We really haven't seen their passing attack for that reason. Maxie Bond tends to play it conservatively when he's deep in his own territory.
He's got that defensive mentality. He feels that's an advantage for the defense down there, so he's going to go conservative offensively.
Samita looking to throw. Intended for Sean Hawkins and nearly intercepted. It was broken up by George Sanker, number 44.
Number 31, Hawkins.
Last week, Aaron Samita made all the right decisions. The two times he has tried to throw today, he has almost gotten himself in very big trouble. Hawkins was open. Samita was just late delivering the ball, and George Sanker almost came up with an interception.
One back now behind Samita on second and 10 from the 20. Quarterback drawn looked like, or perhaps just the pressure forced him away, but he got wrapped up and could not escape.
Tony Khalif. You got to figure anytime anything happens up the middle, number 74 is going to be involved in it. Cornell's offense stagnating, but again, as Sean McDonough pointed out, when you're deep in your own territory, there's only so many things you can do offensively. And with the pressure that they put on, you really are hesitant about going deep right now.
Samita got back to the line of scrimmage, third and 10 from the 20. It's deflected, high in the air, nearly intercepted. Nick Panos, number 99, got his hand on the football and sprawling after it, but not coming up with the football for Cornell was Mark D'Angelo.
Well, Tom Coben's been a busy young man already. This will be his third punt here in the first period. Again, he is punting from deep within his own territory. Lee Rearman, the tackle, does a deep snapping.
Brian Carroll back to receive the punt. He averages 5.25 yards per punt return. Takes a Cornell bounce and is down by Evan Park at the 33-yard line. That's where Colgate takes over. First and 10 with 19 seconds to play in the first quarter.
Let's see if Colgate decides to maybe get a little conservative themselves and just say, hey, let's start to grind it a little bit with Kenny Gamble and see what we can do. For Cornell, they are very pleased, obviously, with what their defense has done, but with all the time they spent out there, they may have some fatigue problems as this game wears on.
Aurora rolling right. Under pressure throws, and it's complete to Glenn Chafee, number 29. He has a first down at the 47-yard line.
Complete to number 29, Chafee.
Gain of 14 as the clock stops for the time being while they move the chains. And that will likely be the final play of the first quarter.
When they roll out Aurora and have Gamble in front of them, you're really pressed on the sidelines because both guys can hurt you badly.
And time expires here in the first quarter before the Red Raiders can get off another play. Our score at the end of one quarter of play here at Shoalcroft Field in Ithaca, Colgate nothing and Cornell nothing.
Take a look at some of the famous graduates of both these fine institutions as we look at some of the scenes of the campus of my alma mater. Senator Edmund Muskie, Christopher Reeve, who was in my class.
That's right. You knew Chris when he was a Cornellian.
See, a former Chief Justice was a Colgate grad. Chief Justice Hughes, Adam Clayton Powell, the famous congressman from Harlem for so many years. Well, it was just a beautifully sunny day yesterday and early this morning. The clouds rolled in. It's still a nice day, but I'm sorry we can't bring you all the sunshine.
No. Beautiful and sunny earlier today and much of the day yesterday, as you point out as well. First play of the second quarter is first and 10 for Colgate from the Red Raider 47. Gamble tries to cut up field and Mike Farley hit him, number 51, making the tackle. Middle linebacker and a senior from Farmingville, New York.
They have denied Freddie Dunlop's best player, Kenny Gamble, for the most part, from turning the corner. And I think the other factor that has been crucial against Gamble to this point, Sean, has been their ability to stop the cutback. Because right there you can see Gamble wanted to cut back, but the Cornell pursuit was there.
Nice to see Fred Dunlap back on the sidelines. He was not on the sidelines last year with the Red Raiders after undergoing heart bypass surgery. Aurora, deep drop, throws to the tight end, Mike Ory. He moves away from two tacklers, still on his feet. Inside the Cornell 45, and he has a first down at the 42-yard line.
Aurora pass complete to number 86, Ory.
Mike Raich in a little bit of extracurricular activity with Brian Fennell. We watched film yesterday of the William and Mary and Duke games for Colgate. We came away very impressed with Mike Ory's ability to run with the football. He gave us another demonstration right there.
Ory is a senior from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Came into the ball game with four catches over the previous three ball games. First and 10, Colgate at the Cornell 42. The fullback gets the call. Todd Buckner ahead for a short gain. Let's go to Mike Madden right now.
Well, up till now, Sean, you've noticed that the Cornell defense has done a pretty good job on Colgate's Kenny Gamble. But what Gamble is enabling Colgate to do is he's giving Aurora more time on play-action fakes. When Gamble's back there in the I formation and Aurora fakes to him, he's got a lot of time to set up and look downfield. Back to you, Sean.
Good point and an advantage for the sophomore quarterback, Gary Aurora, facing a second and 7. Just inside the Cornell 40. Blitz coming for Cornell, and the pass overthrown by Aurora, intended for Glenn Chafee, number 29.
Well, you have a couple of choices when you've got an option-type quarterback. Either you lay back to the sidelines and try and keep him penned in, or you work for immediate pressure from the inside and hope he'll pull the trigger early. That time, Cornell blitzed its middle linebacker, Mitch Lee. Aurora did pull the trigger early and overthrew Chafee.
This rivalry began exactly 91 years ago today on September 26, 1896. Cornell holds the advantage in the series. They've won 44 times. Colgate's won 26, and there have been three ties. Third and seven. Pressure coming. Calhoun couldn't drag down Aurora. He'll run. He's near the first down as he makes it to the 31, and he appears to have it as Brent Foligno and Mike Texedo combined on the tackle.
Excellent coverage in the secondary by Cornell. They went to their nickel situation, and it was just a three-man, four-man pattern. They had it all covered, and unfortunately for Cornell, Mark Bond on his blitz turned the wrong way, and Aurora went the other way, and that got him the opening to get the first down.
At the 31. 12 and a half minutes to play, first half, no score. Cornell hosting Colgate. A pitch to Gamble, running right, and he'll be stopped behind the line of scrimmage. Mike Texedo made the original play. He got help from Len Tokic.
Take an isolated look on Kenny Gamble here as he tries to operate the quick toss to the right side. And we talked about the key for Cornell against Gamble would be Texedo and Tross, the defensive ends. Texedo with an excellent play. There's an injured Cornell player on the near sideline. There's Mike Texedo. Glenn Dedman, who he is talking to, the defensive line coach, said that Texedo was the most pleasant surprise for Cornell. Coming back from the summer, he added 25 pounds, always had the quickness, and he has been a big play player for him. Mark Perlman, the cornerback, is the injured player for the Big Red.
Perlman is a senior from Arlington Heights, Illinois.
Working on a knee or an ankle on his left leg, that's unfortunate.
Maxie Bond in his fifth year as head coach of the Big Red of Cornell. His record, as you see, not that impressive overall, but when you consider they were 8-2 last year and 1-0 this season with a win over the defending league champions Penn, took him a little bit of time, but really not much by today's standards, to turn it around, and it is on very solid ground, the Cornell program right now.
He's done an excellent job the last several years of recruiting good football players here to Ithaca, and that's the real key. You know, many times when you see a new coach come into a program, you've got that adjustment period for recruitment, and Maxie's done a good job. We're going to give you another look at the preceding play where you can see how Mark Perlman gets hurt on the play. Watch the right side of your screen. It was Stuart Tross going over the pile, and whoa, got whacked right on that left knee.
Perlman was helped off the field. Second and 12, Aurora moving away from pressure, throwing deep for Buddy Brown, and it's incomplete. He did not come up with the ball along the sideline. Mike Raich on the coverage.
Well, I can see why Freddie Dunlop has gone to Gary Aurora, because I tell you what, he is all over the backfield. He's going to make some mistakes, as he did in the first quarter with that scrambling. They continue to work on Perlman on the sidelines. It's the left knee they're checking out. But he scares you when he gets out onto the wings.
A fellow named Flutie won a Heisman Trophy a couple of years ago doing just that kind of thing.
Yeah, I remember that guy.
Drops straight back this time, throwing over the middle, too high. Intended for Rick Evans, number 32. There was double coverage there, and a fourth down and 12 upcoming for Colgate from the 33-yard line.
I mean to tell you, Brent Foligno unloaded, unfortunately, hits Mike Rage's teammate, but boy, Evans really would have been popped if he would have been in the middle of that sandwich. They're going to go for it on fourth down.
And they had better hurry. Buddy Brown running into the huddle, and they're just breaking the huddle with 8 seconds left on the 25-second clock. It's now down to 5 seconds. They get it off with one. Blitz coming. Aurora dumps it off. It's intercepted by Jeff DeLavalore. His second interception of the season, and Cornell takes over. First and 10 at its own 32. Aurora looked over to Freddie Dunlap, and because he saw the huddle clock winding down, he said, do I snap this thing? And he said, yes. Cornell coming with an all-out blitz. Look at DeLamalure, number 46, in the middle of your screen. He was coming on the safety blitz, recognized the screen movement, stopped his momentum, and makes a heck of a catch to come up with the interception.
Because if that had been completed to Todd Buckner, he had some room. Samita on first down, looking deep. Chris Hahn is beyond the secondary, and he couldn't come up with it. Juan De La Rosa was beaten by Hahn, but Hahn could not make the catch. De La Rosa might have gotten a piece of the ball.
De La Rosa did get a piece of this ball. Just as it got to Hahn's hands, that would have been a 68-yard touchdown for the Big Red. There's Jeff DeLamalure, the senior. His Uncle Joe was a pretty fair football player for a lot of years. Joe DeLamalure with the Buffalo Bills and the Cleveland Browns. Second interception of the season for Jeff. Boy, that was the home run ball right there. Heck of a recovery by De La Rosa.
And the fourth interception of his career for Jeff DeLamalure. Fumbled football by Malaga. It's on the carpet, and it's recovered by Colgate at the 37-yard line. Malaga never quite got the handoff cleanly, and it was recovered by Colgate's number 57, Matt Jaworski, at the 37-yard line. So Colgate comes right back out on offense.
Second turnover the first half for Cornell. That was just Malaga never putting a handle on it because the handoff was fine and it was open there in the field for it seemed an eternity and nobody really saw it at first. But the Red Raiders with another break, they have been inside Cornell territory most of this first half, but we're still scoreless
with 11:27 to play in the second quarter. Option, Aurora keeps it, now pitches to Gamble. Gamble's inside the 35 and stopped by Donnell Johnson, number 7, at the 32-yard line. Johnson now playing because of the injury to Mark Perlman, who's still seated on the bench for Cornell.
Tackled by number 7, Johnson, and by number 46,
when you have a good option quarterback and a great tailback like Kenny Gamble, you can go to the sidelines and still have several different things you can employ, and Aurora started to run, and when he finally got the trouble, he knew where Gamble was and picked up a few more on the pitch.
Gain of 5, second and 5 from the 32. Gamble has a blocker in front of him, crosses the 30 and makes his way close to the 27 and close to a first down. Let's go to Mike Madden.
Yeah, Sean, I just got done talking to Mark Perlman, and he said that he took one on the knee, but he says he's going to sit out this series, and he'll probably be back in the next series or maybe the series after that.
He's an important member of the secondary, is Mark Perlman. They spot it short of a first down for Colgate. It'll be third and less than a yard, just inside the 28-yard line. Time ticking down here in the first half, down to 10-10 to play. No score. Jeff Kroll is the fullback blocking for Gamble. He was hit at the line of scrimmage, but the forward progress and surge might have picked up the first down for Gamble. Mike McGrain, the man who made the hit at the line of scrimmage. Depends on the spot here.
Mike McGrain knifing through from his outside linebacking position, put a good collar on Kenny Gamble. Cornell defense has done everything you could want, but they have spent an awful lot of time out on this football field, and while Maxie Bond has to be pleased that it's still a 0-0 tie, he realizes his offense is going to have to start doing something because you see the measurement just a little bit shy, and I'm sure the Red Raiders will go for it on fourth down. But he cannot keep asking his defense to make big play after big play against a team that is probably a little better physically than Cornell.
Obviously, you look for Gamble in this situation, but Cornell on that fourth and goal from the 1 stuffed Gamble trying to go over the top. Interesting play call here for Fred Dunlap. Two tight ends into the ball game. Aurora nearly stumbled coming away from center. Mitchell Lee in pursuit. So is Mark Bond. They can't get him. Aurora has the first down and much more inside the 20 and driven out of bounds at the 18-yard line. Penalty flag down on the tackle.
may have a clip the way Brent Foligno is talking. The penalty looks like it may go against the Red Raiders. Yes, it is a clip on the far side. Again, the Colgate offense short circuits down deep in the opposition's territory. They lose the first down here. They've lost a touchdown this afternoon because of a penalty. See if we can see the clip at the end of the play.
White, still fourth down.
Now it's a much different play call for Freddie Dunlap. Aurora on the move on the sidelines. Watch Buddy Brown right here. Number one. Nope, I take it back. It is one of the down linemen who clipped Brent Foligno. That's why Brent knew it was definitely against Colgate.
And not much question about it. A blatant clip along the far sideline. And Fred Dunlap is going to go for it on fourth down and about seven from the Cornell 34. Aurora drops back, throws over the middle, complete to Glenn Chafee. He has a first down at the 25-yard line. They picked Aurora it up by about 2 yards.
Chafee is a big wide receiver at 6'3", 213 pounds, and it was just a quick slant pattern. They caught the Cornell defense, not really set, I think, Sean. It looked like they were still trying to change what they wanted to do in their setup when Colgate snapped the football. So for the first time this afternoon, the Red Raiders convert a crucial play.
Glenn Chafee, a senior from Sterling, New York, a political science major at Colgate. First and 10, flag down, and now whistles stop the play.
I think we're going to get a false start by Colgate. They're going to the quick snap to try and beat Cornell, and I don't think they waited long enough there. They did not.
Illegal procedure against Colgate, 5-yard penalty.
So Colgate will have a first and 15 now. That's how they're trying to compensate for all the different things that Cornell does defensively, is go to the quick count, catch Cornell in the midst of their shifting if they can.
9 minutes to play in this scoreless first half. Aurora, the delay to gamble. Cuts away from a tackler. He's across the 30-yard line and inside the 25, out of bounds at the 21. That perhaps has been the best example of the brilliance of Kenny Gamble that we've seen so far this afternoon.
Number 97, Rick Calhoun, is right here to make a tackle on Gamble, and he just ran right through the tackle attempt. And then he can get to the corner in a hurry. Delamalore and Raitt shut him down, but it is now a second and 5 after the 10-yard pickup.
At the 21. Aurora going to the near side. Wide open is A.J. Thomas inside the 10 and knocked down at the 6-yard line. Donnell Johnson and Jeff Delamalore made the tackle.
Same play they executed the last time they drove deep into Cornell territory. As you see the time remaining, 8:41 here in the first half. They put Buddy Brown and Thomas as twin receivers to one side. Brown goes up the field to clear. And Thomas, the inside receiver, does an out pattern underneath the coverage and picks up good yardage.
First and goal from the 6. Aurora looking toward the end zone, throwing to the end zone. Intercepted! Jeff Delamalore, his second pickoff of the afternoon, and it's a touchback. Cornell will take over first and 10 at its own 20.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. I tell you what, though, I've got to question what Colgate is doing there. You've got Kenny Gamble. You've got four downs. Run it a couple of times. Try and put some pressure on him. Instead, Cornell has the blitz on. You got a young quarterback. He gets in trouble, makes a bad judgment, and throws an interception. He did that twice last week against William & Mary.
I agree with you, Jack. Questionable play calling by the Colgate coaching staff. The handoff goes to Malaga. Off right tackle and ahead for about 5 yards on first down.
The longer that Cornell stays in this ball game, the greater their chances are. They realize that Colgate is the better team, perhaps physically, but as their confidence grows, that advantage gets smaller and smaller.
Well, the two things we talked about at the beginning of the broadcast this afternoon relative to the Colgate offense, their propensity for turnovers and their inability to finish drives and take advantage of good field position. They've demonstrated both of those things thus far in the first half. Samita, under pressure from Panos, lobs it downfield, incomplete. It went over the head of Chris Hahn, intended for Sean Hawkins, but even if he had caught it, he would have been out of bounds. 35 upcoming for Cornell from the Big Red 25.
Not only are Panos, Khalif, Douglas, and Warwick the down four for Colgate strong players, they're also very quick players. Panos, at 240 pounds, was running down Sumita.
Aaron Sumita at quarterback, a junior from Hawaii, an agricultural engineering major here at Cornell. He was 16 of 28 a week ago against Penn. Frank Manego, number 37, in motion. Sumita, straight back, looking over the middle, throwing way too high for Hawkins. He was knocked down. That ball was nowhere near being catchable.
No question on the contact. Dave Bovell bumping in to the Cornell receiver, but it is an uncatchable ball. This is a good call, Sean. Sumita had good time here.
Watch how high this one is. No chance whatsoever.
The bump was right there, but good no call by the officials. Colgate showing like they might come on this punt by Coben.
It's been a busy first half for the sophomore punter. Long count, good snap. They are coming, and Coben gets it away. Ball will go out of bounds at the 45-yard line. Again, good field position for the Red Raiders of Colgate. 7:37 to play in the second quarter, no score. Someday those young ladies might be well-known alumni of these institutions, and we'll look at some more famous graduates from these two schools. Dr. Heimlich, Joyce Brothers, I didn't know that.
There you go, yeah, that's right.
Scenes of the beautiful Cornell campus in the background. Campbell running away. Moves away from Tokish and slides ahead for about 5 yards out to midfield. Gain of five for Kenny Gamble. Second and five for Colgate.
Now that's what Colgate should have done down near the goal line, I thought.
Here at Shoalcough Field, they have spent about $3.6 million over the past couple of years to renovate the stadium. And you see the brand new press box that we are very happy to be situated in. This is a beautiful facility. And as Maxie Vaughn told us yesterday, it really shows the university's commitment to the football program with the upgrading that has taken place here at Shoalcough. Short gain on second down.
Carry by number 35, Crowell.
Todd Buckner, the fullback, got the call for a rare time thus far in the first half. He got about two to the Cornell 48, and it will be third down and a short three. Gary Aurora, a psychology major at quarterback for Colgate. Fakes the handoff, looking over the middle. Wide open is Mike Ory, but it's intercepted by Corky Webb. Webb trying to move away from A.J. Thomas, and he will not. He'll be dragged down, but another interception. The third of the half for Maxie Bond's Big Red of Cornell. They're on offense once again. First and 10 at about their own 18-yard line.
Trying to get the tight end up the middle of the field against a nickel defense. You don't see the nickel back. Gary Aurora didn't see the nickel back, Corky Webb, and he timed it perfectly.
When he was open, Jack, I think a little more zip on the ball instead of a lofted pass that Aurora threw would have got the job done.
But what happens so often in the nickel defense, you don't see that guy on the side, so you put a little more loft on the ball.
Aaron Sumita hands off to Scott Malaga. He is stuffed at the line of scrimmage.
Ball carried by number 30, Malaga.
Greg Minuski led the defensive surge. There's a look at Corky Webb. Checking the scores from around the Ivy League this afternoon. Penn struggling in the early season. Dartmouth looking for its first win in the traditional game against the University of New Hampshire. That would be the first victory for Buddy Tevens if Dartmouth can pull up what would be an upset against the Wildcats of Coach Bill Bowes.
We can't get to that.
Todd Ryman, number 43, the tight end, went in motion. The pitch to Marvin Dunklin, running to his right, breaks away from one tackle and moves across the 20 to the 21.
Greg Minuski, the middle linebacker. Outstanding player for this Red Raider defense, number 58. I tell you, sideline to sideline, and when he has to put the crunch on you, he's right there.
You mentioned last year, Minuski led the team with 162 tackles. 104 of those were solo tackles. He also led the team with 5 interceptions. Easy to understand why he was voted Colgate's defensive most valuable player. And he leads the team again in tackles this season with 37 coming into today's game. 3rd and 7, Samita, quick pitch to Dunklin. He has some running room across the 25, across the 30, and out of bounds at the 35-yard line.
Excellent play call. Cornell had twin receivers to the left, ran a man in motion that way. Colgate backed off expecting some kind of triple receiver route to the short side, and instead they ran the quick pitch, and they had 3 blockers out there for Dunklin.
They mark him out at the 36. It's a gain of 15 for Marvin Dunklin, the general studies major.
Interesting. Cornell has moved the ball on the ground and not through the air so far.
Field position has really put the clamp on the passing attack. There's a pass. What a catch by Sam Brickley at the 37-yard line. He caught 9 balls a week ago. Nothing as spectacular as that one.
Sam Brickley, the junior double major in economics and government. Boy, as an old receiver, I tell you, that brought some chills to me. You can't make a better catch than that. He caught the back nose of the ball. What a grab.
Sam Brickley, Jr. from Landenburg, Pennsylvania. 9 catches a week ago for 72 yards. Best field position for Cornell. They're going for all of it. Man wide open, and it's caught by Hawkins. No, it is not. It's ruled incomplete. Dropped the ball, could not hang on.
Sean Hawkins, who last week set a Cornell record for career touchdowns, almost had another one. Samita put it out where he could catch the ball, and it would have been a nice grab, but he couldn't come up with it. They were going for it all, and they had the Colgate defense rotating the wrong way, and you see Hawkins was out there. That was a great throw, and Sean just couldn't hang on to it. That's rare, too, to see Hawkins drop a ball.
2nd and 10 from the Colgate 38. Samita, bad pitch. It's on the ground, picked up by Malaga. Tries to break the tackle of Sanker and cannot. George Sanker, number 44, made the tackle at the 38. That's about the line of scrimmage. Perhaps a gain of a half yard, and 3rd down and long, about 9, facing the big red of Cornell, but they got away with one there.
Well, we sometimes forget, because he played so well last week, this is Samita's 2nd game as a starter in college football. He's going to have his ups and downs, and he's been struggling here today, although, like the previous play on the long pass, he had it there. It was the other guy that didn't do it.
3:40 to play. 1st half, no score.
Blitz.
Picked up by Cornell. Flag down. Samita throws, and it is incomplete. Sean Hawkins was out of bounds when he came down with it. Along the near sideline, let's check out the penalty flag.
A motion call, I believe, against Cornell.
Penalty flag on the play.
You are right, as usual.
Penalty is illegal.
Now, I would guess that Colgate will decline it. Greg Minuski already says so.
Illegal motion, red, declined. 4th down.
Penalty is refused.
4th and a long 8 from the 37. What do you do, coach?
Well, you're talking about a 54-yard field goal, which I think is out of Quarles' range. He's out there pleading his case with Maxie Bond. I think you go for it here.
Dave Quarles, the place kicker number 2, who you saw, as Jack pointed out, he wanted a shot at that 54-yarder.
We're not going to have to hurry here. They're down to 6 on the huddle clock.
And 3 seconds as Samita Park signals. 1 second. He didn't get it off. The clock has expired, and finally the officials notice it.
I think they did that purposely. Back up 5, and now let Tom Colgan put it.
Dead ball, delay.
I got to tell you, I am still tingling over that catch by Brickley. What a catch. I mean, that gets you as an old receiver. I'm sure Mike Madden feels the same way down the sideline. When they do it like that, it's special.
Now, be honest. Did you ever catch one quite like that?
Think about that.
Don't be modest now. If you did, you can acknowledge that fact. Coben on the punt. Not a good kick. And that will go out of bounds at about the 20-yard line. They'll spot it just inside the 20. He was angling for the coffin corner and came up a bit short. Colgate takes over with 3:11 to play and all three timeouts remaining here in the first half.
Red Raiders will dominate the statistics offensively in the first half, but those turnovers and that costly penalty when they had thrown the touchdown pass in the first period, those are the difference in the ball, differences in the ball game, I should say.
And off to Gamble. He got ahead for about 2 yards. Brent Foligno, number 45, came up from his safety position to make the play. I think the overview of this game, Jack, is missed opportunities for Colgate and not taking advantage of excellent field position.
And as we said a few moments ago, Sean, the longer that Colgate fails to score, the more it's going to play upon them and the more it's going to build Cornell's confidence defensively.
We'll try to show you that graphic a little bit later on as well, because there's certainly a lot to read. Kenny Gamble holds many Colgate records, 23 in all, and many national records as well. Over the middle and nearly intercepted. Mike Farley knocked it down. The pass was intended for Buddy Brown, and Aurora was in danger of throwing his fourth interception of the half.
Tried to run a little look-in pattern to Buddy Brown between the linebackers and DBs. There's all the, I shouldn't say all, many of the marks for Kenny Gamble, who is now the all-purpose rusher. That means kick returns and running the football in NCAA Division I AA history.
Aurora on third down and 8 dumps it off complete to Kyle Sanborn, the tight end, but he's well short of a first down as Len Tokish, number 81, the junior from Seattle, Washington, made the tackle.
And that's what I'm talking about, Sean. Cornell's defense, as this game goes on, feels stronger and stronger. Colgate, in their mind, they start thinking, what are we doing? Why aren't we going? The longer that happens, the better it is for Cornell.
If you were Cornell, would you have called a timeout here to save a little more time on the clock? I'm sure Colgate would
have. No, I think you have enough time. You're going to be in a situation where you want to save it for when you're on offense.
They came after the punt. Crump got it away, a short kick, but very high, fielded by Raich right at midfield.
See, with the fair catch, and that was another reason they didn't call the timeout, they were rushing the punter, so they're going to more than likely fair catch the ball. That stops the clock. They've got good field position. 1:47, there's plenty of time.
Here's our location, high above the 50-yard line in this spanking new press box at Schoelkopf Field.
Beautiful.
Absolutely a NFL-caliber facility, as we were talking about yesterday when we first got a look at it.
Been like that all day.
Brickley went in motion. Samita under pressure gets the throw off up the middle and it is incomplete. Slow call by the officials trying to decide if Dave Bavell had come up with that Aaron Samita throw. He did not, and it will be 2nd and 10 Cornell at midfield.
Nick Pano said, how do you do to Aaron Samita as he released that ball. Samita took a little bit of time getting back up onto his feet after that hit.
No score, 1:41 to play in the first half. You expected a defensive game with these defense-oriented teams. Colgate has missed many opportunities to score here in the first half. Samita dumps it off. It was caught by Malaga. He might have been better to let that one drop because it's a loss of 5 yards on the play.
Second straight time that the Red Raiders have come with a delayed blitz. Actually, that's the defensive end, Don Bedell, who hangs in the line of scrimmage and then loops around up the middle. He has not been picked up both times, and that's put pressure on Samita.
Cornell asked for a timeout with 1 minute and 12 seconds to play in the second quarter. They're facing a 3rd-and-15 situation from their own 45-yard line. Aaron Samita will talk it over with Maxi Bond and Bob Colbert, one of the offensive assistants along the near sideline. He's the gentleman in the green jacket. He's in communication with the offensive coordinator, Eddie Wilson, upstairs.
Well, the thing you're looking for here from Cornell, and you can see the numbers, it's been a struggling first half throwing the football for Aaron Samita. The thing that Cornell is looking for here, obviously they want to try and keep this drive alive and perhaps put some points on the board. But they want to make certain here that they don't cause a turnover, because if they don't get it, then they can kick the ball away and pin Colgate deep and go into the locker room no worse than 0-0.
Let's go to Mike Madden right now. Mike?
Down here, Sean, they've played the first half. It was relatively still as far as the wind's concerned, and that rain has held off. Just about a minute ago, the rain started falling. It's nothing serious yet, and the wind picked up a little bit, but right now it's at Cornell's back. It might become a factor in the second half.
There are some dark clouds moving in from behind the Cornell big red. The end zone off to our right as we look down at the field. Third and 15, Samita. Over the middle and into traffic, and it's intercepted. Sheldon Spicer, his second pickoff of the afternoon, his fifth of the season. Colgate gets the ball back at its own 28-yard line with 1:04 to play in the half.
Well, we talked about them not wanting to turn the ball over, and Aaron Samita put this one up for grabs into pressure. And Sheldon Spicer with his second pickoff, as Sean described for you. Almost as good as a punt, because you put Colgate deep in their own territory, but they have 64 ticks on the clock to try and do something in all three timeouts.
Two receivers split out to the right. Aurora looking to his right, throws for Buddy Brown, and it's ruled complete at the 37-yard line, a yard short of a first down. Clock running, down to 50 seconds to play in the half. Colgate in the hurry-up offense. Red Raiders have all three timeouts left here in the half. Aurora throws. It's complete to Mike Ori. He'll wisely go out of bounds at the 43. He has the first down, and the clock stops with 33 seconds left.
Cornell into a semi-prevent defense situation here. They don't want to allow the home run ball, so they'll let the Colgate offensive players catch the ball underneath coverage, try and keep him in bounds. That time Ori did do a good job of getting out of bounds.
There's the dark clouds moving in from behind the end zone off to our right. The forecast was for sunshine and temperatures in the low 60s. We had sun earlier, we've not seen it lately. Aurora will run with it and go out of bounds at the 47-yard line. That killed 10 seconds. 23 seconds left in the half now.
Well, now defensively, the Cornell down linemen, after they are sure that it is a pass, they're just sort of hanging around the line of scrimmage saying, we're going to give you some time. We're going to make you throw the ball. We're going to make you eat up some of the clock. And when he finally did run it, as you said, Sean, he ran 10 seconds off the clock. And now the three timeouts are great, but they don't have many ticks on the clock left.
Coming up at halftime, Jack will talk with the incoming executive director of the NCAA, Richard Schultz. Over the middle, complete. Kyle Sanborn tripped up by 55, Mark Bond, and a penalty flag goes down, and apparently a late hit.
Jeff DeLamalore hitting Sanborn when he was already on the ground, and now all of a sudden things change, because that's a 15-yard mark off, and it's going to put the ball down inside the Cornell 30. And although there's just 14 seconds left, that's a lot of time to run off two or three plays and perhaps have a chance for some points. Well, that was
clearly a late hit by Jeff DeLamalore.
Dead ball, personal foul, red. First down, we got a white timeout.
14 seconds left in the half. Two timeouts remaining for Colgate.
But what that penalty does is now Colgate can go to the end zone. They are inside the 30, and now it's not a real long passing situation. You can run normal patterns and still get the ball down there with a chance to get a touchdown. When it was back at the 42, 43-yard line, you would have still been trying to pick your way down, and the clock would have been more of a factor for you.
They are now also in Rory Crump field goal range, which they would not have been at the 42. Maxie Bond does not like, not any coaches that I'm aware of, like undisciplined penalties such as those, but Maxie Bond and Peter Noyes in the white shirt on the left of your screen, the defensive coordinator, particularly are sticklers for discipline on defense.
Watch Chafee in the slot, number 29, on the near side.
Flag down as Aurora drops back wide open. The ball was underthrown and nearly intercepted on the rebound. Buddy Brown couldn't come up with it, and it glanced off the hand of Mike Raich. Let's check out the penalty flag with 8 seconds left in the half. It's against Colgate.
Again, they tried to go with the quick count, and they weren't set long enough for the quick count. I'm sure Cornell will accept the penalty. You want to push that ball back.
Illegal motion, offense.
Newton Whitaker, the referee, was the man who threw the flag in the backfield.
Now you got 8 seconds left. You have perhaps time for one more play, something to the sidelines to try and stop the clock, although they do have the timeout left, so that really is not a factor, but something to try and get it closer for Crump to try a field goal.
Or perhaps one shot at the end zone. They are looking short. That ball is way overthrown, intended for Chafee. 3 seconds left, and it looks like Rory Crump, the field goal kicker, is going to come on as the sun tries to break through the clouds.
Well, I know from my years here as a student in Ithaca, hang around long enough, the weather will change 3 or 4 times in a day for you.
This is going to be about a 50-yard field goal attempt for Rory Crump. He missed earlier in the game from 38 yards. And going into the breeze slightly. It's more across the field for Crump, his right to left. Mm-hmm. From the left hash mark, out of the hold of A.J. Thomas. It is blocked. And that will end the first half.
Field goal attempt blocked by number 13, Rach. At the end of the first half, the score.
So a dejected Rory Crump and the Colgate Red Raiders head off at halftime in a scoreless tie with the Cornell Big Red. We'll be back to Shoal Caulfield after this word from your local public television station.
I presume the Mona Lisa has been stolen.
This week on Mystery, Sherlock Holmes confronts the final problem.
This is a duel between you and me, Mr. Holmes. If you are clever enough to bring destruction on me, rest assured, I shall do as much for you.
The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes on Mystery.
Arch enemies face off tonight at 9. A desperate American seeks to free his mother from a German prison camp. It's Escape, starring Norma Shearer and Robert Taylor in Love and War, tonight at 11.
Come with 13 on a nostalgia trip. Relive your favorite moments from our first 25 years of the finest in performance and public affairs programming. Join us every Sunday night when we turn back the clock. It's 13 Revisited.
Was the Watergate scandal deliberately hyped by a sensational news media? Bill Moyers talks to people who thought so. That's a 1972 rebroadcast in defense of the president, Sunday at 11.
Monday on 13. On the Adams Chronicles at 9, has Abigail had it with John?
In the 13 years that we have been married, less than half of that time have we been together.
On American Masters at 10, the 10-year lunch of the 1920s, a feast of quips, cuts, and caustic comments by the coterie of quick wit at the Algonquin Roundtable. And on the premiere of America by Design at 11, the design of the American house. That's Monday on 13.
Voter registration deadline is fast approaching. Connecticut residents who want to vote in the April presidential primaries must enroll by October 13th. For more information, contact your election board. And don't miss tomorrow's debate between the Democratic presidential candidates at 3:30.
Raiders of Colgate University. The first series of the football game. It was Cornell on offense, and Aaron Samita, his first pass was picked off by Sheldon Spicer. Colgate took over inside the 30-yard line of Cornell. Could not score. They went for a field goal of 38 yards. Rory Crump, and he missed it wide to the left. On their next possession, it was Colgate moving down to the 1-yard line. On fourth down and one, they went for it, and Kenny Gamble was stopped at the goal line by the Cornell defense, which has risen to the occasion on several situations this half. Jeff DeLamalur with 2 interceptions defensively in that half for the Big Red. Now let's have a word from Colgate University in Hamilton, New York.
Metaphor I love to use is this tiny little institution, small but tough, that attempts to play Division I athletics. it's that sort of stretch and reach and try to excel and maybe do more than we have any right to expect we can do. It's Division I athletics. It's not a squeaky little quartet, but it's a full symphony orchestra. It's not three or four dramatic productions a year, but it's 14. It's not one or two off-campus study groups. It's 16 all over the world. It's women's studies, Asian studies, Native American studies. I think we do an enormous amount for a school our size.
Polonius in this play, it's of course funny. Polonius approaches Hamlet, who he thinks is kind of crazy. What do you read, my lord? Hamlet's reply, words, words, words.
So one thing we do is gain a fuller understanding of the riches of our tradition we've always held on to and appreciated. The other thing we do is to be creative, to be critical in new ways on new issues.
So for the first time in Chicago's history, two black reformers are elected to Congress.
Life has a meaning, but it must be searched for. And that takes intellectual labor, it takes sweat, it takes cajoling, pushing, pleading, it takes teaching.
It wasn't the right to vote that he was in Memphis for, it was the right of people to a decent standard of living.
I think it's very important for the students to see that the world is interdisciplinary. That in order to grasp the problem and have any hope of solving it, you have to see it from lots of different eyes and different angles.
So that's an example of how angular momentum controls the spinning of bodies.
The quality of research by faculty members at Colgate over the last 5 years has increased dramatically. It's an active faculty. That's very important to keep a place like Colgate with high vitality.
And you have to be one with them, see? That, I think, is one of Colgate's strengths, too. Because we realize that our main job is to get hold of these young men and women and excite them and open up doors that never have been opened before. And you remind them this is your one last chance for most of them. They'll never be able to do it again. When you think of where they come from, my lord, they come from all over the country, and they come here in a valley with some buildings on a hill, and they call it Colgate. And for 4 years, it's the end and being of their lives. Then they graduate and look back nostalgically. You can't blame them if we do our job.
A visit to Colgate, one of this nation's outstanding universities, and at halftime, the Colgate Red Raiders and the Big Red of Cornell University locked in a scoreless tie, a half dominated territorially by Colgate, but they weren't able to get in the end zone against the pesky Cornell defense led by three interceptions, two of those from Jeff DeLamalore. Let's go upstairs now to my colleague Jack Corrigan. He's standing by with Dick Schultz, the incoming executive director of the NCAA. Jack?
Thanks, Sean. I am here with an old friend, Dick Schultz, at one time the athletic director here at Cornell University from 1976 through 1981, and now the incoming executive director of the NCAA. And Dick, you are replacing a legend in Dr. Walter Byers after 30 years, turning over the reins of the NCAA. How are things going to be different in the Dick Schultz era?
Well, probably from an operational standpoint, not very much different. Just because I think of the difference in personalities, I'll probably be out more. Walter's style was to more or less work behind the scenes, and was a private individual, outstanding man, a great administrator, and I just really don't know very many people who could have started the NCAA from scratch and built it the way he has.
Now, of course, there has been an awful lot of success from the NCAA point of view in recent years, but at the same time, as in anything, I guess, Dick, there are some problems. One of the areas that came to light, of course, this summer, the problem with player agents and the subsequent ineligibility of some players. How is the NCAA going to try and address the agent situation?
I think the agent situation is one of the toughest that we have to deal with, basically because we're pretty well restricted with what we can do. Because of antitrust legislation, restricted trade, there really isn't any control that we have over the agents. The only thing we can do is, of course, penalize the athletes or the institution if they knowingly play an ineligible athlete. So we're trying to
NCAA staffers and other people around college sports, they said there was little question that Dick was the man they wanted, and he's going to do a great job. Looking at the second half that's upcoming now, if you're Colgate, you threw the ball 21 times with a first-team All-American in your backfield in Kenny Gamble. He gained 52 yards. You threw three interceptions. Do you go back and try Kenny Gamble a bit more often here in the second half?
Well, they are throwing the ball a lot. I mean, they came into the ball game averaging 33 passes a ball game, so it's not like they do not throw the football. But I think they may, as they get down into Cornell territory in the second half, if they do, they may think about trying to perhaps be a little more conservative, just let Gamble try and do his thing. I think Mike Madden had a very, very strong point when we were talking a few moments ago, Sean. The opening possessions of this third quarter for both teams are going to go a long way towards determining what happens the rest of the way.
Aaron Samita showing why he's a quarterback and not a wide receiver, having a tough time hauling in that pass and nearly getting our cameraman, Andy Robinson, right in the head.
Now Colgate deferred after winning the opening toss, so they will start with the football here in the second half, and I think we'll go a long way towards determining what happens to this Cornell offense or this Cornell defense against that Colgate offense in this opening drive. Now Cornell apparently has been penalized for coming out of the locker room late because the ball is back in the 25-yard line.
And Dave Quarles will kick off. You saw the first half numbers for Kenny Gamble. Gamble did not return kicks last week because he's been bothered by a little bit of a torn cartilage problem in his rib cage, which, as you know, Jack, can be very painful. Gamble averaging 28.2 yards per kickoff return. Cornell is a team this year averaging 24.4 yards per kickoff return, and that's 15th in the nation. Gamble is back deep with Stacy Harris, number 34, and this is the first activity of the half for the place kicker, Dave Quarles, the senior from Farmington Hills, Michigan. We're underway in the second half. No score. Stacy Harris from his 18. Across the 30 and 35, across the 40 and 45, and dragged down in Cornell territory at the 47-yard line. So we see right away why Colgate is among the leaders in the nation in kickoff returns, as Stacy Harris brings it back across midfield, a return of 35 yards.
Well, first the penalty yardage, and then the good return by Harris. Colgate has had great field position all afternoon. They better start capitalizing on it. Injured Cornell player being assisted to the sidelines. That's Dan Miller, a backup linebacker, a junior out of Baltimore, Maryland. Transfer from Brown.
Gary Aurora threw three interceptions in the first half. He's still at the helm, fakes the handoff to Gamble. Looking downfield, complete to Buddy Brown. He took a hard hit from Jeff DeLamalur. That came after he picked up the first down at the Cornell 31, a gain of 16 on the first play of the half for Colgate.
They're doing an excellent job of beating the Cornell two-deep coverage by sending a guy out into the flat to contain the corner man and then curling Brown or A.J. Thomas underneath the safeties.
Buddy Brown was wide open. He's a dual major in economics and political science at Colgate. This time, Gamble does get the call, and he breaks free up the middle, across the 25 and down at the 24-yard line, a gain of 7 on first down for Kenny Gamble.
Good to see Mark Perlman, who made the tackle, back in the ball game. Perlman had a little ding on his left knee in the second period, but he's back out there. I think that's what Colgate has to do. I mean, they just got to take some of the French pastry off of this offense and just say, give it to number two and let's go at him.
1 minute played, second half, no score. It's Cornell hosting Colgate. Gamble up the middle. He has the first down as he makes his way to the 20-yard line.
Ball carried by number two, Gamble.
Ball came loose. Mike Farley ended up with the football, but apparently after the play was completed, Gamble is not getting up. He's still down at the 20-yard line.
Kenny Gamble led the nation.
Well, as you mentioned, Sean, he had problems with the rib cage, and that might be part of the reason why they have not done that much power running this afternoon. He might be very tender at it. We're isolated on Kenny Gamble. This is a sprint draw. Take it deep in the backfield, break against the grain, and right there, he took a pretty good pop up around his shoulder and shoulder blade on the right side, and he is still, as you see, on all fours at the 20-yard line. See if we can see it from this angle.
The 1987 Cornell lightweight football team
went head-to-head with Jeff DeLaMalore.
Next Saturday afternoon as Princeton comes
Gamble
to Shokoff
led the nation in rushing
contest.
Last year, 165.1 yards per game, best among all Division I AA backs. He was first in all-purpose running, 220.5 yards per game, and he finished second in scoring with 126 points. He's getting up slowly, and I think it was the head-on-head collision that might have dinged him just a bit.
They're asking, Kenny, what's your name? There's Dan Miller, the young man who was injured on the second half kickoff. This appears to be a right knee problem for Dan.
He's a transfer to Cornell from Brown University. He had to sit out last year.
Well, they bring in J.J. Cordy as the new tailback for Colgate. Freshman out of Vestal, New York. That's just around the corner.
We should point out Colgate playing without Jeff Way, who had been their starting fullback the past couple of weeks. He has a sprained knee. There's an incompletion. Well out of the end zone was Buddy Brown. And second and 10 upcoming for Colgate from just inside the 21.
Brown had beaten Mark Perlman with an excellent move in the end zone, but Aurora was getting so much pressure from Mike Farley and company that he couldn't keep the ball in play.
Second and 10, Colgate. 13:23 to play, third quarter, no score. Aurora under pressure, and he's taken down by Corky Webb, the nickelback, back at the 32-yard line. A loss of 11 yards on the play.
This time, Corky Webb, as the nickelback blitzes right into the rollout of Gary Aurora, and he has rolled back to the 32-yard line.
Mike Madden has made his way over to the Colgate sideline. We hope to have an injury report for you in a moment about Kenny Gamble. Third and 22.
And a big play here for the Colgate offense that has struggled on third down situations all afternoon.
Plenty of time for Aurora. Now he's running out of time, moves away from Tuxedo. He has to run, and Webb takes him out of bounds at the 28-yard line. Well short of a first down.
Tackled by number 22, Webb.
Fourth and about 17 upcoming for Colgate, and let's see if they try Rory Crump once again. He's 0-for-2 on field goals this afternoon. Missed one wide left and came up short. Looks like they're going to go for it.
They are going to go for it. They've got a fourth and 17. Cornell makes a couple of substitutions. Derek Wilmot, junior mechanical engineering major, comes into the ball game replacing Gary Rinkus to try and perhaps get a little more speed on that defensive front, put some pressure on Aurora.
From the 28-yard line, fourth down and 17. Aurora throws, and it's incomplete. He short hopped the tight end, Mike Ory, and the Cornell defense holds once again. The offense comes on the field for the first time in the second half. First and 10 at the Cornell 28.
Well, the great concern right now for the Colgate Red Raiders, the condition of their All-American tailback, Kenny Gamble. If he can't go anymore this afternoon, it certainly changes not only the play calling, but the attitude of that Colgate offense.
Aaron Samita had a rough first half. He hands it off to Scott Malaga. He moves forward across the 30 and out to about the 33-yard line for a gain of almost 5 yards on first down for the Big Red.
Well, this is a carbon copy of what the Big Red did so much last year in going 8-2. The offense struggled its way to find some points, but the defense has played so well, it made the difference in the ballgame. They won 3-0 last year over Harvard, for example. The defense just said, all right, we're going to close the door. The offense is going to get us some points somehow, and we're going to win a football game.
Malaga now with 38 yards on 11 carries. Second and 5. Samita swings it out to Malaga. Cuts toward the middle of the field and breaks free. Scott Malaga may go all the way. It's a foot race. Scott Malaga at the 20, and he's dragged down at the 17-yard line. Juan De La Rosa made the saving tackle.
Well, the one thing the Big Red lacks in the backfield this year is true breakaway speed out of Scott Malaga. But he does so many things well. that a 50-yard screen pass results for the Big Red, their deepest penetration of the ball game. Malaga does some nice running here as he stepped through a couple of tackles and then just took off running before De La Rosa ran him down.
A 50-yard gain, first and 10 Cornell with a 17. Samita toward the end zone for Hahn, and a penalty flag is down as he collided with Juan De La Rosa.
Samita was really popped as he let go of this football. But you're going to have the penalty against the Red Raiders. Pass interference against Juan De La Rosa, and the Big Red will have the football down inside the 10-yard line.
Juan didn't like the call. He's a junior from New York City, New York.
Defensive pass interference, 15 yards. The ball will be on a 2-yard line. First and goal.
So now the Big Red with their best opportunity to score. Hahn was behind De La Rosa. You can't really see all of the contact from that angle, but as the ball went from the inside to the outside shoulder of Hahn and he flipped his head, that's when De La Rosa made the contact.
Officials stopped the play. And I believe Colgate has taken a timeout here.
Now, I think Freddie Dunlap wants an explanation of the penalty, why a 15-yarder is not half the distance. While we've got a moment here, let's go down to Mike Madden as he's got a report for us.
Well, we've got some good news and some bad news for the Colgate Red Raiders. The bad news, of course, is that they got their backs up to the 2-yard line. The good news is that their number two, Kenny Gamble, he will be back. I talked to Kenny. He said he got popped in the shoulder, but he assured me he will be back. And especially, I know if Cornell converts on this one, he'll be back in the next series.
They did not charge a timeout to Colgate there. They did get the explanation, as Jack pointed out. Well, and they did not win the argument if they were arguing because the ball's still on the 2-yard line.
What happens inside the 20-yard line on a pass interference call? You march off the complete 15-yard penalty. Freddie Dunlap was looking for half the distance, but you don't get it on the interference call.
First and goal from the 2. Malaga stopped short. Barely got back to the line of scrimmage.
Tried to go behind Doug Langan and Lee Rehrman, their best blockers on the right side of the Cornell offensive line. This is going to be a tough 2 yards against that big defensive front line of Colgate.
Bob Colbert signaling in the play to Aaron Samita. No gain for Malaga, second and goal from the 2. 10:45 to play, third quarter, no score. This is the best chance for the Big Red. The Red Raiders have been here before. The pitch goes to Tim McDevitt. McDevitt in trouble, and he is tripped up way behind the line of scrimmage back at the 8-yard line. Steve Aldero, number 21, the strong safety, made the big play, the sophomore from Verona, New Jersey.
I had an old coach who always said, in a track meet, you run between the lines. In a football game, you cross the lines. Tim McDevitt got caught in the track meet there, running between the lines, the 10 and the 5, instead of trying to go north-south into the end zone. It cost the Big Red 6 yards of very valuable real estate.
Now it's third and goal from the 8. Malaga blown back behind Samita. Looking to the end zone, lobs it out for Hahn, too far, and Cornell's guilty of a pick play as a flag comes down. Hawkins ran a pick for Hahn.
They're not going to call they're going to call Conte again. I mean, Greg Minuski unloaded. Nope. Well, I was looking one way and now another, so it looked at first from the indication that it was going to go against Cornell because Minuski really hit Hawkins. And the call does go against the Big Red for the illegal pick, which will be offensive interference.
Sean Hawkins ran a pick
offensive
for Chris Hahn. It was pretty obvious.
Red, 15 yards, loss of down. Fourth down.
Well, Cornell doing just what Colgate has been doing all afternoon. Crucial mistakes down deep in your opponent's territory, and the Big Red is going to have to go for the field goal now.
These two teams can't stand prosperity.
Well, everybody in football, you can go from Pop Warner up to the NFL, runs the pick play, particularly down near the end zone. You just have to disguise it a little better than Cornell did there.
That was obvious. We could see it clearly from here. Dave Quarles on to attempt his first field goal of the afternoon. He was 1 for 2 last week against Penn. Kick is up. It's got to go. And it's wide to the right.
Field goal attempt is no good.
It's a So both teams with crucial errors deep inside of the opponent's territory. That's why we're still scoreless with 9:49 to play in the third period.
Colgate has missed a field goal and had one blocked. Dave Quarles misses. And Kenny Gamble is back in the ball game as the Red Raiders take over on offense, first and 10 from their own 23. Maxie Bond really in the ear of one of the officials along the near sideline. Aurora got tangled up with one of his backs. Tokish got a piece of him. And then he was finished off by Mike Texedo, number 95.
There was a real mix-up from the get-go for Colgate on this one. Gamble, I think, went the wrong way, or Aurora did. Then he got tangled up with Buchner, and then got tangled up with Tokish and Texedo, and that hurt a lot more than the first couple did.
While we have a second, we want to send along happy birthday greetings to Rose Lanning, watching the game on Long Island. Rose is the mother of our director, Bob Lanning. She's celebrating a birthday today. I don't know if we should mention how many, but we certainly pass along our warmest wishes to Bob's mom. Here goes Kenny Gamble, around left end and dragged out of bounds at the 29-yard line. Picked up 17 yards on the play, but he's still short of a first down by about 4 yards.
Mike Raich, the cornerback, had to come up and make the play. That's what Gamble can do so well, the cutback. See all that Cornell wash, the pursuit? Now they're chasing a guy that they can't run with. And Raich, who has been an outstanding corner man for Cornell for a lot of years, is the guy who makes the stop. Otherwise, it might have been off to the races.
Aurora, rolling right, cuts back toward the far side of the field. Look out, he moves away from Tross. Now throws up the field, and it's overthrown. Intended for Rick Evans. Gary Aurora, again in Flutie fashion, Evans moving away from the rush, incomplete. But he could not complete the pass downfield for Rick Evans, and flags down for play. Illegal motion, the call, going against Fred Dunlap's Red Raiders.
And I would assume the Big Red will decline the penalty and force the Red Raiders to punt the football.
Mm-hmm.
You're right, Gary Aurora. He's running a little bit of
motion. Offense refused.
He's wearing down the tread on those shoes this afternoon. He went every which way to Cornell's defense. Good job again this afternoon. They're trying to.
Cornell might have had too many men on the field, but there are no flags down. They were late getting their punt receiving team out there. Raich hauled in the kick from prompt and has swarmed under after a 2-yard return at the 32-yard line. First and 10 Cornell at their own 32 with 8:38 to play in the third quarter, and there's no score in the game.
Look at some other scores from around the Ivy League. Brown in the Governor's Cup in Rhode Island leading URI 10-7 in the second quarter. Bucknell, wow, 25-0 over the Penn Quakers. Northeastern and Harvard, the Crimson have taken the lead on the Huskies. Lafayette leading Columbia by 2 touchdowns now, and New Hampshire rolling on Dartmouth.
On first down, the handoff to Malaga. That's been the primary first down play for the Big Red this afternoon, and it picked up 3 yards, perhaps 4, out to the 26-yard line.
I think you have to give an awful lot of credit to junior Doug Langan out of Staten Island, New York, the business management major. He has done an excellent job on Tony Khalif this afternoon, mm-hmm. the defensive tackle of Colgate. Khalif has been involved, but he has not dominated like he did a year ago.
Second and 6 from the 36-yard line. Marvin Dunklin gets the call. He's going to throw it, looking for Chris Hahn, and it is incomplete. The Red Raiders saw it coming, and Juan De La Rosa combined with Paul Angelino, number 26, to break it up.
Chris Hahn makes a good adjustment on this ball to try and get to it, but De La Rosa, that's outstanding. He turned his head back just in time to avoid the face guarding call. That's just good defensive backfield play. You were right, though. I think Dunklin might have given that away just a touch too soon, Sean. They were right on top of that play.
Juan De La Rosa, number 15, was an outside linebacker last year and was fourth on the Colgate team in tackles with 55. Now a cornerback. Under pressure, Samita moves away, flag down, looks like offensive holding. The pass is complete to Tim McDevitt. If the play stands, he'll have a first down at the Colgate 49, but I believe it's offensive holding back at the 30-yard line against Cornell.